Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the People's Law School. Tonight, it is my great privilege to present to you Mr. Ed Gentle. Ed Gentle is a Rhodes Scholar, and I guess that's sort of like being a Marine. Once a Rhodes Scholar, always a Rhodes Scholar. I don't know, because I wasn't one. But Ed practices law in Birmingham, and he has an unusual specialty, and that is he is the state administrator for all of these billions and billions of dollars of monies that are handled in these large class actions. You're familiar with, I know a couple of them that he has handled, are the breast implant cases where women received money there, thousands of women and billions of dollars, and also the PCB case down in Anniston where they poisoned Anniston, and he's handling all the money for that. But to let you know, this is a great position of trust that our judges have placed in him, and he has risen to the occasion. For your information, he graduated from Auburn summa cum laude, and when I first heard that, I went. But also, he was a Danforth scholar there. He graduated summa cum laude, and then thereafter, he graduated from the University of Alabama as a Maytag fellow. And then thereafter, he was a Rhodes Scholar at Oxford University in England. And then at the University of Alabama School of Law thereafter, he was a Hugo Black Scholar. So Ed Gentle is one of those people that usually you will find he'll be working for some big New York law firm or somewhere like that, and not in the state of Alabama. But I've said this before, and I mean it. Is that he is a great treasure for the state of Alabama. He has single-handedly, first of all, I know that he has been the lawyer for the Alabama Senate to help guide those people to do what they do, and I don't know whether they listen to him or not, but he is also, we all know, has our Constitution, the Constitution of the state of Alabama is one of the longest and worst in the world, but he and two others have written a new constitution, and someday, if there's ever an amendment and all of us vote for a new constitution, it is my bet that the one that will be adopted is the one that he and a couple others wrote. So to let you know, Ed has been involved in many cases that other normal lawyers wouldn't even think about, and he has the mental ability to take them and do them, and I'm just real proud to know him and glad that he's come to us tonight. As I said, he practices law in Birmingham, and it is my honor and privilege to present to you Mr. Ed Gentle.
Thank you, Alan. Thank you. Good to see you. Good evening, everyone. Whenever Alan introduces you, you don't have to take it from there. I mean, it's he always overestimates someone's ability. I'm going to talk this evening about some mass tort settlements. I think Kobe will tell you that the way law is evolving, more and more cases are mass torts. By that I mean you settle a bunch of cases at one time. We're going to talk about a particular type, and that's called a community settlement. And that's usually when you have a toxic substance, or what the plaintiffs say is toxic, defendants may disagree, that's pervaded one neighborhood. And I've had different ones over the years. I've had three train wrecks, for example. What's a train wreck about? Usually a car or two derails and there's a fire. And there's 1,000 to 3,000 families that are impacted, kind of like Mount St. Helens. There's soot and there's fire. And they tend to be in remote locations. Anybody know where Castleberry, Alabama is? I thought you didn't. Well, there's one there. There's one in Bullitt County, Kentucky. Anybody? West Point? And that's where they tend to be. And likewise, some of these other community torts are in remote areas. Blackwell, Oklahoma has a zinc smelter settlement. Anyone heard of Blackwell? Okay. Spelter, West Virginia. No? You've heard of Anniston, though, right? Okay. At the time that that plant was built in Anniston, though, it was a remote area. And so a lot of times, these plants are put in remote areas. And eventually, you know, they shut down or the laws change, and then all of a sudden what was legal becomes illegal. And that's the defendant's perspective. All of a sudden they have this case against them. And then it's fought about, and you then have a settlement, and then I'm asked to come in and try to make peace. And usually when I come in, everyone's still upset. For example, in Anniston, people have PCBs in their blood and they can't get it out. And the mom arguably passes it on to the child across the placenta. So they're very angry. In other areas, like in the West Virginia zinc case, smelter case in Oklahoma, they have lead in their houses. And so a lot of times we come in and we're asked to make peace and to get the claimants to buy into a settlement. Kobe, you're going to be my reference since we have another lawyer here. Kobe will tell you that in a class action, you can do one of two things. You can accept the settlement or you can fight on. And so my job is oftentimes to sell it to an angry community. And what you do is you have boots on the ground. It's kind of like nation building. What we do usually is we first figure out who the angriest group of folks is, usually about 6 to 12 people, and we put them on a claimants committee. Doesn't that sound like a crazy thing to do? You take the most vocal people, but you try to turn them and you try to convince them that the deal's a good one. The other thing you do is you have a claims office in town staffed by who? Locals. And so you try to translate the settlement into the community's, you know, thought process. You try to just become part of the community and try to sell the deal. And so we have some examples here. We talk about here an Oklahoma case I had mentioned. 25% of the people wouldn't take the deal. They opted out. That's the fancy word for you don't take the deal. So we had to go back on the ground and win half of them back to have a deal. And that's usually what you have to do is you just have to get in there and work on it. In Anniston, I love to fish and my claimants do, so I have two fishing parties at my house a year. And slowly we've sold the settlement to that group. And it was a very difficult and angry group to sell. And so you bond with the community. So that's what these first few pages are about. And oftentimes you have some difficult issues that you have to sell to the community. Sometimes it's difficult. In Anniston, I had 6 written death threats, for example. And I think 5 were veterans, so they could kill you. So you have to keep those things in mind. And we also had some difficult problems. In Anniston, we had about $2 million in surplus left. We had 18,000 people. So do you pay everybody a few dollars, or do you take that money and extend the life of this medical clinic we have to treat those that are really needy? And so we had to sell that to the group. And so those are some examples of the practical issues you encounter in trying to sell a settlement to the community. But you just have to become part of the community. For example, I'm Santa Claus in three towns every year and that sort of thing. So let's talk about just a few practical issues in creating one of these settlements and carrying it out. So we're on this practical issue part. So the first thing you might ask is, every time you see one of these settlements, you have some fancy map that doesn't make a lot of sense. That's this attachment A. And so that is a zinc smelter settlement. And you might ask yourself, you might give Kobe a copy. We got some more in the bucket back there. But you might ask yourself, how was that configured? Anybody have any ideas about what spreads a toxin around a community?
Wind.
It's 90% wind. And so that's what you have here. This attachment A is the result of a wind study. And you have that whether you have a quick type of contamination like a train wreck or a zinc smelter that was in Spelter, West Virginia for 90 years. But that's how you plot it out. And then you have some experts that tell you all the addresses of the folks. And that's one thing you have to have a class action is ascertainability. Fancy word, meaning you got to figure out who's in the class. So that's how you basically do it with a community tort. And then the next thing you do, of course, is you try to plot out how you're going to recover. And so you draft a complaint, right? And so an example is an attachment B. This is the one that led to a $380 million verdict in West Virginia. In 2008, it was the third biggest jury verdict in the country that year. The biggest one involving individuals and not businesses. And that was drafted by the Levin Papantonio firm in Florida. You've probably heard of them. And so you might ask yourself, these are very old plants a lot of times. Like the zinc smelter in West Virginia was established in 1890. And the lawsuit was brought like in 1980. So how could you sue somebody when the thing has been there that long? You've probably heard of the statute of limitations in a lot of these presentations. Usually it's 2 years. You know, after you're hurt, you have a certain amount of time to bring the lawsuit. So any ideas about how you can get over that problem? Oh, as long after that. Well, the reason is because a lot of times the substance is still blowing around the area. So it's an ongoing, continuous harm. And so that's the theory that the plaintiff lawyers try to come up with. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, and we'll explain that in a minute. And oftentimes it helps us settle the case because it's an unknown. Will the judge throw it out? Will the judge let the case go forward? And then as you can see in that complaint there, there's some pretty traditional claims. that lawyers will tell you about. There's negligence, which means you have a duty of care to your community not to hurt your neighbor, and you did. There's nuisance, which is a form of property damage. You're having this toxin go onto the other people's property. There's trespass, because it's going onto your property. And then there's this fancy remedy called Rylands v. Fletcher. Anybody heard of that? Okay, it's an English case. And it basically says if you have something toxic on your property and you let it get away, be it like a bull or like PCBs, you're strictly liable for whatever happens. It's a nice remedy. And so that's talked about a lot in these cases. And then finally, in some states, not Alabama, you can ask for something called medical monitoring. And what it deals with is a toxin, for example, that has long-term effects that you can't measure. So, for example, in West Virginia, we have cadmium, arsenic, zinc, and lead. And that might cause cancer over 30 years. And so you can't have a traditional approach like you do in Alabama with a car wreck. You have a car wreck, either you're hurt or not, right? If you're not hurt, you don't recover. But if you have lead contamination and you sue, you may not be hurt for 10 years. So what do? In Alabama, you don't recover. In West Virginia and 12 other states, you can have a medical monitoring remedy in which we can monitor your health over a long period of time. And then you could sue at that time if you're actually hurt. So that's a remedy that matches the malady. And that's a very progressive remedy. But in these examples that I have here, Alabama, Oklahoma, Kentucky, and West Virginia, the only state that has that is West Virginia. So that just shows, for example, why you should vote tomorrow. Because laws are very important. Some states have more progressive laws than others. And you might think, West Virginia progressive? Did you know that West Virginia eliminated the death penalty in 1968? It's a progressive state. It really is. So then let's talk about how these cases resolve. A lot of times the case is so big, the defendant will try to wear down the plaintiff lawyer, meaning they'll try to have them go broke, just to be frank about it. For example, in the West Virginia case, the out-of-pocket expenses were, anybody want to take a guess of the plaintiff lawyers? 7.6. How many law firms have 7.6? Do you have 7.6? Okay. But DuPont, that defended the case, had 7.6. And that often happens, and so that's one big factor. Another example is in the Aniston case, there are 18,000 plaintiffs, and Monsanto was deposing every single one. How much would that cost? About $18 million, huh? And so, you know, that's a factor. So cases should be decided on merit and not attrition. Wouldn't you agree? And so that's a big factor in these cases, and sometimes it works out and sometimes it doesn't. In the West Virginia case, it tried to a jury like we talked about, and there was a verdict for $380 million against DuPont. And then it went up on appeal. And there's a 174-page opinion if you're having trouble sleeping one night. But in that decision, they provided the kernel for how we settled the case. It talks about, I've got a quote in here, and the court decided that the lower court, you know, the appeals court sent it back to the lower court with instructions, which happens a lot on an appeal. It had to decide, and I've underlined this language, when the plaintiffs possessed the requisite knowledge to trigger the running of the statute of limitations. And so that's the same issue we talked about. So if you lived around this smelter, did you file a lawsuit within two years of when you found out there was a problem? For example, you might have seen that there's some lead on your property, or maybe your child has lead in their blood, or someone has cancer. And what they're going to do, what the Supreme Court asked to happen, is that for the 8,500 people, I was a special master. I was to have 8,500 jury trials on when each person knew. And so again, even though the Levin Papatonio is very powerful, that incented them to settle the case. And so we mediated the case, the judge and I did, and it settled right in the middle. Remember, the verdict was for $380 million. It settled for $200 million. And that oftentimes is about what you see. So that's one reason a case settles, is attrition. And also some factor that's unresolved. In the PCB case, I've got an article in the Alabama Law Review that talks about its settling. One reason it settled is that Monsanto threatened bankruptcy. That's often done, right? So Monsanto was facing quite a few lawsuits at the time. Donald Stewart had 3,500. The case I administered had 18,000. And so Monsanto was feeling the attrition also. Another big factor, and I think this is the Boy Scout factor, CSX. Let me brag on CSX for a minute. When CSX has a train wreck, you know what they do the next day? They set up a pay station and start paying people. Any other defendant that you're aware of that does that? No, no. And you know what? It works out for them. You know why? Every dollar gets to the claimant mailbox. When they pay Kobe a dollar, he keeps 40 cents. So it helps the defendant. It helps the defendant. It takes the fire out of the case. And so for all three of the train wreck cases I've had with CSX, they've done that every time. And so by the time the plaintiff lawyer gets there, by the time I get it, I'm just kind of cleaning up the people that CSX missed. And a lot of times it's only a third or a half of the total payout. And this is really, I think, this is the result of a creative thought by a friend of mine with Vincent and Elkins. He's a defense lawyer who actually gives me cases. I know that's unusual for administrators to get cases from defendants, but he thought this up. And you know what else they did? They represented BP. You remember when BP first had a settlement? They had Kenny Feinberg do the same thing, right? He had a pay station with $25 billion. He started paying the victims directly, and guess what? Kobe didn't get 40%. It was brilliant. It helps the goodwill of the defendant with the community, and it's better use of your money, right? And so you can't fault them for that. Another reason a case settles is that there are similar cases. You heard about that Tout case that just came out. What, there was a $72 million jury verdict, a week or two ago? Now plaintiff lawyers around the country are trying to round up more cases. In the Oklahoma zinc smelter case, Phelps Dodge owns that zinc smelter, and they're watching the DuPont case in West Virginia. And after that one settled, if you look at attachment, let's see, C, I think. Yeah, I compare the two deals there. And so you'll see the Blackwell, Oklahoma case is a mirror. So in the Spelter case, we got $66 million in cash to clean up about 2,000 properties. And so Phelps Dodge, they mediated that case. And for their 4,000 properties, they paid almost exactly double, $119 million. And so a lot of times, one case will serve as a cookie cutter for another. Now, not every Tout case is going to pay $72 million, I would think. But it certainly lets people know that those cases have great value. Okay, now let's talk about an issue that's pretty divisive, legal fees. So what happens next is after you have a deal, you know, we talked about, you know, finding the class area, filing your lawsuit, resolving the case, having a settlement. You have a lump settlement, right, a bucket of money. Then the lawyer wants to be paid, right? And so sometimes it's not controversial at all. Sometimes it's very controversial. So I've talked about legal fees in here. One thing the lawyer gets, of course, the lawyer gets reimbursed for all these out-of-pockets off the top, and they may be high, $7.6 million or more, for example. But, you know, so say a lawyer creates a pot of money. What do you think is a fair percent for the lawyer to get? Let's say you have 3,000 people, and you have a $200 million pot of money for them. What 30, should, what 35. Should, 35%?
50%.
50%. I like this group. All right, sure.
As a class action, you said that he gets his out-of-pocket expenses off the top first.
Right.
All right. Just me, just my lawyer, if I've got a case,
yeah.
Same thing, he gets out-of-pocket expenses?
Depends on your contract, right, Alan?
Yes.
Some contracts say it's off the top. Some say they may just get a flat percent.
Okay.
Read your contract.
So if, you know, why doesn't that apply to the class actions also? You get a flat percent and you take...
Well, in a real sense, in a class action, the judge is making the decision on what the deal is. And so that's what these two cases, for example, I have here talk about, this K case and this, Aetna case. And so the reason is, for example, in the West Virginia case, if you have 3,000 families, it's probably not practical to get all of them to sign an agreement. So you sign an agreement with a handful of people, and they're called the class reps, and you bring the action. But when you recover this bucket of money, it's not fair for lawyer just to say, because I signed up with five people, I'm going to apply their contract to everybody. So the judge intervenes in terms of fairness. So it's really up to the judge. So we have a 35 and a 50. Any other thoughts? 3%? 10?
As the person that received a 75-cent check from a class action lawsuit settlement, 3%.
3%. Okay. Well, there's really two approaches to it. almost always the lawyer has to keep track of their time, just so the judge can measure what all you did and their expense. And so that'll let the judge know how much of your life was devoted to this case. And then there's two ways to do it. There's a lodestar, and that has a lot of factors here in this Aetna case: how long it took, how smart you are, how risky it was, how impossible the case was, that sort of thing, and the result, that sort of thing. And then the lawyer will get an award. Another is just the percent of recovery approach. And so in class action, it hovers around 20%, give or take. It varies. Now, that worked out fine in West Virginia. In Oklahoma, what happened is that of the recovery, the defendant paid $49 million to do the cleanup while the case was going on. And the plaintiff lawyer's got a fee on that, too. What do you think?
The percentage of the $49
million? Anyway, the community's very divided on whether that's fair. The defendant paid it while it was ongoing. It wasn't part of the settlement amount. But when they figured out the percent, they added that to the 39 more. So there's 49 and 39. That was the total recovery for the cleanup. So that's the problem. Another case that's very controversial is the Anniston case. We've talked about class action so far, right? Anniston was not a class action. It was 18,000 individual cases. And the lawyers had, like you, individual contracts for 40%. So they got 40% of $300 million or $120 million and not 20%. What do you think?
You have a case where complex and several thousand hours and
yeah.
affect the competency of the attorneys.
Yeah.
But a lot of times when the judge is making these determinations,
right.
He doesn't know how many people are going to opt out, does he?
A lot of times by the time you have your fairness hearing on the fee and the settlement, the opt-out period has run. Sometimes it's not true, but a lot of times it has. He probably has a good idea. She probably has a pretty good idea at the time. Anyway, in Anniston, a lot of the claimants think it should be 20%. Anyway, for what that's worth. Okay, then when you have a settlement, we've gotten the bucket of money, we paid the fee, and then who runs it? And that might seem simple. You'd say, well, Ed, you run it. Well, that's interesting because a lot of times the defendants won't leave. And so I've got an example here of this West Virginia case. And what happens in the West Virginia case is we have this medical monitoring remedy, and I'm paid as we go. DuPont's the defendant. They fund it as we need the money. And so they're very concerned about the expenses and how it's run. And so what they did is they filed a motion to fire me, which is not the first time, by the way. But I love this judge. So if you read down, this is one of my favorite quotes. So he talks about everything, and then this is what he says of DuPont's motion to fire me. To do so would be tantamount to the inmates running the asylum. And so the thought is that you need a neutral to run a settlement. But DuPont has a point. I mean, it's their money. They pay each year, and they don't want to just, you know, walk away from it. What happens a lot of times is this, unfortunately. After I pay the plaintiff lawyers, they've been paid in full. A lot of times I have trouble getting them to help me, whereas the defendant stays there because the defendant doesn't want to waste its money. Now, there's a handful of plaintiff lawyers who hang in there and really help me, and I think the greatest one in the state is a fellow named Mark Engelhart in Montgomery. He was wonderful in the PCB case, for example. But there's a handful of lawyers that really help me out, and that makes such a difference because if they don't, you have an imbalanced settlement, right? At that point, unless the lawyers stay, the plaintiffs are unrepresented, and so it's really important for the plaintiff lawyers to stay. In the Oklahoma case, we had a similar problem with Phelps Dodge. Phelps Dodge does a lot of mining all over the country, and so they do a lot of cleanups, and so they're familiar with doing lead cleanups and all, and they wanted to do the case. I mean, even though we had settled, and so we fought about that a while, and so the compromise is in Attachment D. What we did is we decided that I would be the CFO and I audit all their bills. We do all the cleanup with RFPs and lowest qualified bidders and all that sort of thing, just to keep that balance there between, you know, the claimant's rights, it's their money, and the defendant's expertise. So that's worked out pretty well. Now, let me talk about some ongoing problems in these cases. You know, one is getting claimants to participate in a settlement. It's pretty easy for a train wreck, right? You get in line the next day, there may be a few fist fights, but you just stay in there and you get your check, right? There may be a release on the back, but you're paid. It's pretty straight. Let's say you have contaminated soil, and I want to dig up your property and tear up all your bushes and put in new soil. Would you just do that, even if your soil has lead? How many people would agree to do that?
Why can't you also demand that they replace your bushes?
Well, you can, but it may not be perfect. It's going to be a lot of dust. It's going to be some annoyance. What we usually do, in fact, everyone I've ever done, we pay people. We give them $5,000. If I didn't do that, people wouldn't do it. Likewise, we want to HEPA-vac your house, replace the carpet, replace the insulation. Would you do that for free? $500, that's what we pay you. And also we relocate you. You have to, right? People just don't do anything for free. That's been my experience. Now, and that's why medical monitoring is a really big problem. So with medical monitoring, you're supposed to be tested for disease every 2 years. So I've got two of those right now, and each cycle, every 2 years, participation is cut in half. So I get half of a half of a half. Why? I'm not paying you anything. Why would you be tested? You're just going to find out you have cancer, and then you've got to sue. So that's just human nature. And it's probably not ethical to pay people to be tested medically. And so we're just kind of stuck. And so I think I've talked about this remedy a little bit. The solution is to build in a grid, so if you get sick, we just go ahead and pay you, so you don't have to sue again. So, for example, DuPont, if you get cancer, just pay a certain amount based upon the type of cancer. Then you go, right? Because there's something for you. But if there's nothing for you except congratulations you have cancer, you're probably not going to go. And so medical monitoring has that problem with the remedy. All right, let's talk about an ethical issue that's brewing. In Anniston, we have a medical clinic for our claimants. They get free primary and dental care. They get prescription drugs really cheap, even cheaper than Walmart. And so now, 11 years out, we're going to wind up the clinic in June, and we have all of this medical data. Monsanto has other litigation around the country about PCBs. They would love to have the data. Any problems?
Privacy.
Tuskegee. It's happened before, right? So what would you do?
Seal the data.
Well, I think if Monsanto gets it, certainly we have to make it anonymous. A lot of claimants agree with you. They say Monsanto should get it under no circumstances. In West Virginia, I've got an example of an order here. The judge decided that we'd use it for research. That's an attachment F. So in that case, it may not be as hot an issue. We have medical monitoring data there, but that's certainly an ethical issue, and I don't know the answer to it. That's why I put it in here. Now, another issue that we encounter in almost all settlements is you have money left at the end. We've talked about Cypre, right, a couple years ago, didn't we? So if there's a little money in a lot of people, like I had a Conyers, Georgia fire case, $100,000 left, 3,000 people, we just gave it to some charities. But what if you have, $2 or $3 or $4 million in 1,000 families? And say, this is in the West Virginia case, more like $1 million. Don't want to overpromise. And you have roads that are damaged by the remediation, and maybe people want some ditches and alleys repaired. And you could do all that and have no money left, or you can pay it out to the people. Thoughts? Yeah, we're going to have a town meeting about it. So I think those are my issues, and surprisingly, the one we just gave, the people decided to repair the roads, and they decided to pay out the money equally, even though you can see from that drawing on Attachment A, some people are closer to the plant, some have more properties than others, but they decided to be fair and just pay it out equally to each other. Any questions?
What about this lead in the water thing? I hear
Flint.
In Alabama now. Are you going to be involved with that?
I don't know. We had an NPR reporter from Connecticut come to Anniston Friday and interview some of us. So I think that the water the lead in the water issue in Flint has really precipitated a lot more concern than there used to be. Yes, sir.
In a situation where the harm was done before a law was changed, in other words, at the time the process was taking place, it was not illegal.
Right.
And then they pass a law. can you go back and hold somebody responsible for a time when he had no obligation?
That's the argument in the PCB case. PCBs weren't outlawed until 1977.
Well, and, you were still using them after 77, though, right?
Yeah, but the plant stopped making them. And now this lawsuit's about that plant.
So how can I be held responsible for something I did when the law didn't prohibit it?
It's a good question. That's certainly the defendant's perspective.
What's the answer?
The answer is to find out, I guess, by having litigation. It wasn't resolved. You know, it settled without DuPont, excuse me, without Monsanto admitting it did anything.
On what grounds can you litigate?
Foreseeability.
You could do it on that or that it's a nuisance.
But let's assume that I'm a scientific plant of some kind,
right,
and I'm making things, and to the best of scientific community's knowledge, there's no harm. Later we find out there was.
Right.
If they could not foresee this, how can you hold them responsible?
That's a great question. You know, even now, the one thing we know PCBs do is cause acne. It's called chloracne. The rest is debated. It's not resolved. But that's a good example of this problem with these toxic torts. We have a toxin in the community. We don't really know what it does, but people grow up and they die and they're gone. And so is there a remedy or not, or do you have to wait? There's not a good answer to it.
Back years ago, I presume it's not going on now, but when we first started working with radioactive devices,
right,
we did not understand the implications.
Yeah.
What can you do about it? How can you hold somebody responsible for things that nobody knew?
That's a great example, and I'll tell you a couple things I know about it. You know, there are some bomb studies out west, and there was some recovery against the federal government by some neighbors. And a lot of times when that happens, you use that as a benchmark to settle other cases. Not too long ago, I'm not going to give even the state, there was a CT scan settlement for over-radiating some people. And those bomb studies and their recovery were used as a benchmark on what would be a fair compensation. Now, is any of that fair? I don't know, but it's just you have the victim's claims and the defendant's defenses, and that's why you have the courthouse. There's not a concrete answer.
CT scans.
Right.
We understand the amount of radiation that's going in. By the time CTs came along, there was pretty good knowledge of the implications from a molecular standpoint.
True.
Of what's going on. But like, I've been to the Trinity site. And as I was driving by, I wondered how much radiation I was getting residual from that.
True. Yeah. Remember,
there's a little monument there.
Yeah. Remember, Oppenheimer didn't know if the reaction would stop when they experimented.
We didn't know a lot of
them. We sure didn't. Yes, ma'am.
My thought on that is, there's no way for a large corporation to know specifically what might happen in the future, you know, that their products would in the future be responsible for. But because they are a large corporation operating in an area of risk,
right,
because there's always risk involved when you're doing these major, major endeavors, that risk management should come to play in that corporation. And they should have a certain set aside all along the way for when problems occur that they could not specifically foresee at the time.
But see, at the time, from the defendant's perspective, PCBs were perfectly legal. In fact, they're in great demand.
Agreed.
Yeah.
But we know DuPont, we know the tobacco companies hid a lot of knowledge of health impacts before they became public knowledge and before certain things became illegal. So how do you dive into their scientific studies that they've made secret?
Right. Yeah, a lot of times you're right. It's not what you do, but how. When you find out that there's a risk, you have a duty to the community to tell them. I agree with that.
Doesn't it also kind of play a little bit into they're in the best position?
True.
To have known rather than an individual.
That's so true.
That's a real life factor in some of these decisions.
It certainly is. I agree with that.
That plays into like his question. They should have known if they researched.
It's a tough issue.
But didn't you say that Anniston, when they built the plant, was way out somewhere?
Mm-hmm.
Is there any culpability with the people? It's like
I moved next to the airport, now I want the airplanes to quit.
But you know, from the people's perspective, it was a great source of jobs.
Yeah.
And in fact, a lot of these plants, I think Anderson too, they had housing for you. And in West Virginia, it was like a coal company. It's the zinc smelters on a peninsula surrounded by a river. They have houses that you would rent for chit, you know. Mm-hmm. You don't really get cash. They have a company store, you buy all your stuff, and they have a bridge, and they lift up the drawbridge at night. What does that sound like? So it varies. Yes, sir.
Now, here's a thought, because we've had a lot of this in Huntsville, you know, when Redstone Arsenal was created, had a wife whose grandfather was dispossessed of his land, and 740 acres in Redstone Arsenal.
Right.
They paid him.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, we've had four chemical companies operate under the management of the Army.
Right.
Roman Harms, Ole,
yeah.
Thiokol, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even in Triana, you know, there have been problems in Triana, which I'm sure you're familiar with.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Could you briefly repeat that?
We were talking about in Huntsville, there are a lot of manufacturers that actually work directly with the Army. That happened, too, in the West Virginia zinc smelter. You need zinc to make bullets. I think it's part of the brass casings. And so the government actually took over that plant during World War II. And so a lot of times you might think the government might have some say in it or some culpability.
The DDT issue out on Redstone was a big one.
It was. Interestingly, DDT is being brought up now as a great way to control mosquitoes. So everything's got pros and cons. Yeah, it works though on mosquitoes.
Yeah, DDT's been used commonly as a herbicide and an insecticide.
Yeah.
There have been noxious chemicals that have been produced under, you know, under contract. Those type plants are called GOCO plants, or government-owned contractor operator.
Right.
Because they're on government facilities. But the question is,
yes, sir.
If you're dealing with the federal government who is, in effect, paying these people,
right.
Is there another level of problem that you deal with?
There could be, or maybe another level of liability. Could be.
The government often assumes liability. For example, when you had the swine flu shot, the drugs companies were basically ordered by the government to inoculate everybody against the swine flu, and so thereafter the government assume responsibility for the drug company's liability. And they do that, but it's like, I guess it depends on whether the Republicans or the Democrats are in office, you know, whether you have a charitable state of mind or whether
you cannot sue the federal government, am I correct, unless they agree to the suit?
That's right.
It varies. It varies.
This comes out of the English law of the king.
Sovereign immunity, that's right. Butts v. Economu. Yes, sir.
Do you find that now any of the large companies are using that risk management approach?
I think they do. For example, if you look at the 10-Qs and 10-Ks of these publicly traded companies, they'll reveal the litigation they have, and they'll have a fancy word would be a material loss contingency reserve or a FASB 5 for the accountants. So it's an amount they're holding as an estimate of their liability, like you're talking about.
The other thing is that when we used to bid government contracts, after all your development production, the last stage is decommissioning. And it seems to me that in general, commercial companies, Monsanto, DuPont, BP, everybody else, doesn't seem to ever really actively pursue that decommissioning stage.
You know, part
and
of it too,
really
yeah,
should
yeah.
be in it, yeah. part of the cost, even though it's not incurred until
stockholders don't want to pay for that, they want price.
Yeah, no, it is part of the cost. And you know, a lot of these settlements are historical. So for example, the CSX approach to a local disaster is to fix it.
Yeah.
And actually it comes out cheaper. And it keeps community goodwill. And I think long term, I think that's what you see. But these are just historic They're anachronisms, right? They're old events that happened before the law was what it is now. And so I think the laws evolved, and these are just like anachronisms. They happened before the law was as it is now, a lot of them anyway. And again, a lot of times, in fact, all of these cases, this is the biggest employer in town. You know, when my dad came out of the Depression, smokestack smelled like jobs. And so it was good, right? They thought it was great. They didn't know it poisoned them. So it's a trade-off. Yes, sir?
You had mentioned that in the settlement of the mass torts, I guess the plaintiff or the defendant attorneys assist you in the settlement.
Yes, sir.
Are they paid for that work?
It varies. Sometimes you have what's called liaison counsel, and they're paid as you go after the settlement occurs. The defendants are always paid. Those lawyers are paid. But a lot of times the plaintiff lawyers get one chunk and then they leave. In my West Virginia case, I was able to get the plaintiff lawyers paid on an ongoing basis, and that makes a big difference. Because, you know, people, like we just said, they tend not to do stuff for free.
Just kind of summarize, you tend to not be the prosecutor or the defender. You're the guy that comes in and referees afterwards.
Yes, sir. I'm a neutral. I'm not a very good neutral at times, but that's what I'm supposed to do. Thank you very much.
So your question is, what does it mean when the judge says to your objection, he says, overruled? That means you didn't win. If he says sustained, that means you're doing good. And then the other side can't do what they wanted to do in your case. But, you know, we were talking about judges. George and I were a little while ago, and we were talking about judges' latest rulings. You know, stare decisis, things like that. What does all that mean? And it means the latest ruling in a particular case is what the judge is supposed to do in your case, if it's an identical case. And so we were arguing this case one time, and I kept saying, Judge, but this and this and this is what you must do, and whatever. He went, bam! He said, Alan, I just overruled you. You got anything later than that? So those are the kinds of things you put up with. And I always think about it's the Charlie Hooper moment when he was a prosecutor and somebody like Phil was the defense attorney, and the drug addict had not done what he was supposed to do prior to trial. He had stayed on his drugs or whatnot. And so Charlie Hooper said, well, I'm just going to reluctantly, I know I said I would recommend probation, but I'm just going to reluctantly recommend probation. And Judge Snodgrass looked at him and he said, well, I'm just going to reluctantly grant it.
Take a case on a contingency fee basis, and typically that's a case where a person has money that they believe that they're entitled to. Cases such as a collections case, a car wreck case, medical malpractice case, those are the types of cases that you can take under a contingency fee basis. There are different types of cases, for example, in an alimony or a child support type case where you cannot take a contingency fee based on what you recover, but instead you would work by the hour. Contingency fees can range anywhere between typically a third up into about a half of the total recovery. There are certain cases that you'll hear about, for example, Social Security disability, that have limited fees where the attorney can only recover 25% of whatever they've collected on the back pay, or even in a workers' compensation case where they're limited to 15%. And some of that's governed by statute as well as other applicable law.
The hardest thing for me is people often say, how do you defend somebody that's guilty? And that's an easy question. The greatest generation, greatest group of men ever gave us a Constitution, United States Constitution, and it says the government's got to do certain things. Prove you're guilty beyond a reasonable doubt, you have presumption of innocence. And there's nothing easier in the world for me than defend a guilty person. because then I feel like I'm doing a civic duty for the community, making government go through their paces to prove my client's guilty. Now, I generally try to focus and specialize on innocent clients, and those are always the tougher ones, because if a guilty man is found guilty or guilty woman is convicted, hopefully they're just going to get their just rewards. The concern is an innocent person being convicted on my watch, then the system's failed. And to me, and people love the adage, better that 9 guilty people go free than 1 innocent man go to prison. And this is the absolute truth, because when they're sitting there beside you and you just know that they're innocent, it's a great, great weight on your shoulders. It's always tough trying a case. Like I said, having an innocent person beside you, it's a great weight, and that's what puts the weight on and takes the hair off.
The question is that in a multiple plaintiff claim or a class action lawsuit, it sounds like the injured party doesn't receive as much money. However, the injured party in a case such as what you described, let's say a videotape return agency, back when VCR tapes were popular, there were late fees that were assessed and things of that sort. And although the individual consumer only received a small portion of what the total settlement was, there are a lot of lawyers and a lot of hours that went into that, along with expenses that go along into the prosecution of claim.
So, stopped the criminal action.
And it did stop the bad act. It may not have been criminal per se, but it did stop the bad action. And so that's one of the reasons why we have attorney's fees, is because, frankly, the government can't babysit all the bad actions that go on in society. And so fortunately, we do have lawyers that can go out there and fight for the individual person.
Is all the evidence in a criminal case admissible in a later civil case?
Yes.
The answer is no. No, and it's because there are different burdens of proof. And there are different standards, and there are different parties. You have the state versus the defendant versus somebody else versus the defendant in a civil case. And the burdens of proof are different. There are different trials. And I will also tell you, having seen several cases tried twice, like a guy gets charged with robbery, murder, he gets convicted. Later, the case is overturned in the Supreme Court of Alabama. It comes back, it's tried again. I've done this. You don't even recognize the case the second time around. Or paternity cases, the jury hangs up the first time. They can't figure out whether he's guilty or not of being the father of the child. That used to happen often before DNA a long time ago. And you try it again, and it can't be brought up. The prior jury verdict cannot be brought up to the second jury. Welcome to the graduation of the People's Law School. We finished another exciting spring here in Huntsville, Alabama. We're here in the city court of the city of Huntsville. And the students here have now all received their certificates. And as you can see, we've got some people here, some of whom have been here before, like my friend Herb Hayes. Mr. Hayes, you look at me like, don't ask me anything, but what do you think, Herb? You always sit on the back row, but you always have intelligent questions. Have
I
you
like
enjoyed the program?
I like to work with Thaddeus in here, and I've learned a lot over the last 7 or 8 years of coming.
No, I learned a lot, and I had questions that I did ask, and I think my questions all got answered, and I think it's excellent.
Now, Kathy has the old Huntsville magazine. It's the magazine you see down at Five Points, and when you buy it, you don't throw it away. It stays on your coffee table for a long, long time. But we have advertised for many years in her magazine because of that one reason, and we seem to get good results, by the way. Yeah. By the way, what do you think, Judy?
I think this sessions have been very informative, and it's given me things to discuss with my family. And the one that made the most impression on me was the don't sign the arbitration clause when you go into the nursing home.
What was your best program? What do you think?
Well, I have to agree with the arbitration thing, because I'm actually going through this with a family member.
Yes.
And I had no idea that we had the right not to sign it. So I was delighted to find that out.
Excellent.
Because definitely my family member is not competent.
There we go. Bonnie, how about you?
I really appreciated what Mike Wisner had said about taxes, because I'm going through incredible things about figuring out how to work with my taxes now. So that's really, it's my first year. I got a doctorate, and I learned more in this year with People's Law School than I had learned getting my doctorate.
What do you think? Have you enjoyed the program?
Oh, I've really enjoyed the program. I appreciate all Gwen's work and all the lawyers coming here. I've been able to talk to family members about the different topics that you've introduced me to. So, and much like them, I've learned a lot about the taxes and especially the nursing home. So I really appreciate all the hard work everyone's done.
Wonderful, wonderful. How about you, sir? What is your observation?
My observation is that it's a wonderful program, and if you could possibly export this to the local high schools.
And let me, along that line, talk to Mr. Jimmy Robinson right here, who spent 20 or 30 years teaching high school.
Well, this has been an excellent overview of the law in general, and recently, since I retired from teaching, I got on the state registry as a courtroom interpreter for Spanish, so this has been a great point of contact for me, as well as an overview about all the different aspects of law.
I've enjoyed all the lawyers that have came to talk to us. Just couldn't imagine that it would be so good.
I think it's excellent. I'm amazed that you can get the kind of people to come and speak to us that you have. And one significant thing that I never thought about is after a trailer truck accident, he pointed out that either the person's dead or on the way to the hospital, so there's only one side to represent them.
That happens more than you know, and it's just not just in truck cases. It's in all cases. There'll be some little old lady lying there on the side of the road, and they don't tell her version to the policeman. And I have this case going on, and right now I have two just like this, and they say, so the policeman wrote it up wrong. Well, let me tell you that the law is that the policeman's report is not admissible in the evidence, so the jury will never hear it. He came up last, and he's just merely recording, so the accident report is not admissible. Think about that. What do you think, sir?
I heard about the program years ago, and I'd always wanted to attend, and I just waited until I retired and decided to come to the course, and I've been pleasantly surprised.
Excellent. Thank you, sir. And let's see.
I appreciate Alan and Gwen and Thaddeus and his team putting this on. And I know it takes a lot of work to get it going. I've had a good time. I've learned a lot of stuff. This is my second certificate that I've earned through here. And I look forward to taking these messages and these lessons to my students at Buckhorn High School. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now, Chelsea, we saved you for last because this is your first course. What do you think about the course?
I think this is an awesome course. I found out about it just last week, so I'm really excited that I came this week. I have to say this is an awesome group of people. They were kind enough to let me graduate with them with Gwen's name on my certificate. I feel like I have to say that because we're in a court of law, and I have to be truthful about that. But this is an awesome program, and I'm looking forward to it if you do it again.
Thank you so much. And on behalf of all of us at the People's Law School, we thank you, and we'll see you soon.